So this talk, I think it's not going to be super long. It might be like 30, 40 minutes, including I have a demo at the end to kind of show you. I picked the talk that I had the best demo for to present. So I think I'll make it more fun. So there's some time for the demo at the end. And then I think, what do we do, Jason? We just open it up for questions and it's kind of like an ask me anything.
Yeah, I think we'd have a Q&A at the end. That'd be great.
Sweet. Yeah, so I think there'll be time for that. All right, so I'll jump right in. Also, please feel free to interrupt me and ask questions. If you can, it's easiest probably to just jump in on the mic. I don't mind that at all. But if you can't, because you know, I know sometimes it's all COVID, we're like and distributed across households across the world. Sometimes there's other people trying to sleep. You definitely type your question in the chat. Either Jason will see it and mention it to me, or I'll see it and answer directly. Cool. So today, the specific research project I'm going to talk about is sort of an old one. This is something I worked on in my PhD, but it's relevant to what we're also working on today, since we still work on music processing. And it's a really great example of how unsupervised learning can and sometimes kind of hit a new point on the trade-off curve, can kind of give you the best of both worlds in some sense. And so I'll try to kind of talk about general unsupervised learning while at the same time I'm talking about this specific task. So the task we're going to do is something called piano music transcription. So let me just give a little preview. So we're going to be building systems where the input is actually an audio file, like a wave file, of someone playing an acoustic piano, like an actual, you know, whatever 18th century piano, not a digital MIDI controller, any of that, like an actual acoustic piano with no electronics in it. And so recording might sound something like this. First question, did that audio come through on your speakers? All right, I see Jason nodding. Okay, great. Okay, so that'll be the input to the system. The goal of the system is to take inputs of that kind of audio and to produce as output a symbolic representation of the actual notes that were played on the piano keyboard. And so here I'm showing sheet music, which is the kind of age-old symbolic representation of music for humans to read and to process. What we'll actually be predicting in the systems I'll tell you about is not sheet music directly, but rather something which you might have heard of before. It's called MIDI. This is a kind of digital music representation format that basically records how the piano was touched over time. So what we're showing here is like this little matrix. It's got time on the x-axis and the note or the piano key on the y-axis. And these little blue bars say at that time, that note was pressed and it was held until the blue bar stops and then it was released, right? So this actually contains more information than sheet music. You can, though it's a little bit tricky, you can go from MIDI to sheet music if you need to. The reason we're going to be predicting MIDI is that it's more useful for some of the kind of digital remastering that that we hope systems like this can allow. Also, MIDI directly records how hard you pressed each note. With sheet music, that's just kind of annotated with kind of metadata on top of the notes. So it's a little bit more direct here. Okay, so this is what we're trying to do. Now, one thing is, if you've ever heard of speech recognition, or you've probably seen it in action when you're like interacting with Siri on your phone, this is a very analogous task. In speech recognition, the goal is to take an audio file of someone talking and figure out the discrete symbolic words that they said, like convert it to actual digital text rather than just the sound of text being read. We're basically doing speech recognition for pianos. That's kind of the task, okay? Now, why would we want to do this? Why would we care? It's a valid question. For example, if you were playing a MIDI controller, like a digital piano, there's no need for any of this. It will just write down the MIDI for you. It'll directly spit out the MIDI you played. So why do we care about this? Well, the reason we care is that a lot of the most interesting and best performances out there are old, done by kind of piano masters on acoustic pianos that may not exist anymore. Like they've since been destroyed. It could have happened like in the 1940s or the 1950s. And musicologists are very interested in being able to, for example, analyze the ways in which kind of different virtuoso pianists interpret music and therefore touch the keyboard. So this could enable downstream analysis like that. Another reason is that there's a lot of things that have been played historically on acoustic pianos that have never actually been transcribed into sheet music so that other people can play them. One domain where this is fairly common is in jazz music, right? Where people are kind of improvising on the fly, and we might have recordings of them improvising, but if a professional musician has not sat down and done the painstaking process of like listening and trying to figure out exactly what note they played when, we don't have the sheet music. No one else can try to, you know, replay those impressive improvisations. So having a system that could do this accurately would enable a bunch of cool stuff like that. Finally, the other thing you can do, and I'll show you an example in the demo, is you can actually use this to remaster audio, right? Instead of just like doing signal processing on a piano recording of like Richter, this famous pianist, Russian pianist in like 1960 or whatever, you could actually figure out the way he touched the keyboard, and then through a much better synthesis process, completely remaster the acoustics, even change him to be playing a guitar if you wanted to, for example. So there's a lot you can do once you have these discrete representations. Cool. So now let's start with supervised transcription, right? The goal of this talk is to tell you about unsupervised, but first I want to tell you about what is the kind of more traditional machine learning approach that you may have seen before, so that I can explain A, why unsupervised learning might be necessary, and B, how it's different, okay? So here's the cartoon of supervised piano transcription. Again, the goal is audio signal is input. We want to build a system that when you hand it some new audio file it's never seen before, it can accurately figure out what notes were in that audio signal and what order they were played in with what time. How do we do this? Well, we directly build a conditional model that might give you, for example, conditional probabilities on symbolic music outputs given your input source data, the wave file of the recording, all right? This might be something like a big neural net, for those of you who've seen neural nets before. Now, how do we make sure the model is going to actually produce the right sheet music instead of just some bad sheet music that doesn't correspond to the audio? Well, we make the model extremely complex and we give it parameters. Basically, we ensure that there are a sufficient number of different little knobs within the model. If you turn the knobs, you kind of change what the model does when it sees new acoustic music, change what kind of outputs it would give you. You make sure there's enough knobs that we're relatively confident there exists some setting of all those knobs that would create a model that would do the right thing on a bunch of different acoustic inputs, right? So make a big model, and we got to try to find the right knobs. How we find the right knobs is really where the supervision comes in. So supervised learning means that the data you fit the model to actually has inputs and outputs all the way along. Like every training example both tells you what the input was and what a human said the correct answer was. So that might look something like this. Of course, it'd be more than three examples. It'd have to be like thousands, but here's a little cartoon. So we have like three different wave files, and then here's three different, you know, correct symbolic transcriptions of those wave files. Now, in supervised learning, we would take the model, really the model class we defined, setting the knobs would give you a specific model. We take the model class, all right, and we see what it does on all these training examples. We see for the current setting of its parameters, W, all the different knobs, is it doing the right thing? And at first the answer will be no, because we're just gonna have to randomly initialize the knobs. But then what we do is we form an optimization problem that's set up to say, find the parameters W that maximize the accuracy of your predictions on all of these training examples in your supervised data set, right? And then through a process that looks often something like gradient descent or stochastic gradient descent, we learn W. Learning just means optimizing on the training data to make sure you're getting the right answer, right? Once you're done, we hope that, and this is where the problem is gonna arise with supervised learning for this task, we hope that if I were to now hand the system a new audio file that it had never seen before, that it would have kind of found the right pattern in the training data it had access to, so that now it can accurately generalized to this new audio file. And even though it never seen it before, it can still predict, you know, high quality transcriptions, like accurate symbolic transcriptions, okay? So the problem with supervised learning in this domain is specifically about that last step. It's about generalization. The problem is that pianos actually sound, at least to these machine learning systems, they sound very, 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 very different from one another. What this means is that if, you know, for some particular piano in some particular acoustic environment, like in my house, for instance, if all my training data were collected from that piano and I fit the model to the data from that piano, I would be totally good when it came to trying to do transcriptions on new recordings from my piano. The problem is, as soon as you move to a different piano, the system will have no idea. Like, it turns out that these things do not generalize as well as you might expect. Unless they've already seen data from a particular piano, they're not going to do super well. Now, of course, if we're talking about transcribing Sladislav Richter's like last recording of 1961, like, where's that piano? Like, you know, maybe it's in the Juilliard School, maybe it's in St. Petersburg, maybe it's in Moscow, maybe it burnt down in a fire. Like, we don't know. We cannot get data from that piano anymore. So this creates a big problem. So as a preview, what unsupervised learning is going to be trying to do differently is, instead of learning the parameters from the supervised data that we can actually collect because we have access to recordings that we can get the ground truth for, instead, unsupervised learning is going to try to directly fit the parameters of the model to just audio files. It's actually going to try to learn on the fly from the acoustic data from the piano you're trying to transcribe. All right? Therefore, it's unsupervised because it's never actually going to see any examples of here was the input and here was what a human said was the right output. All it will see are examples of here's some inputs, figure it out. Okay? So, now, can do a little more detail. So I said, like, pianos are very different. This creates a problem. Let me start talking a little bit about piano sounds. Like, we're gonna like take apart a piano just a little bit to get some intuition. I'm gonna use this for two purposes. One, I'll make it a little more concrete what I mean by different pianos sound different, and this can be a problem for supervised learning. And two, I'll reveal the kind of data structures by which our eventual model that I'll eventually describe is going to reason about acoustic signals. So you'll see little depictions of them. And then I guess third, I said two things, but there's a third thing. Third, I'll point out the kind of biggest challenge when it comes to actually making this unsupervised, which comes from the piano being a polyphonic instrument. So, I mean, here's a picture of the strings of a piano, right? Hopefully we've all looked inside a piano at some point or another in our lives. This is what it looks like. If we zoom in on a single string, here's what the piano looks like in kind of the resting condition. There's a big metal string kind of for the lower notes. It kind of looks like a spring, actually, but it's just like a big metal thing, right? It's got some tension on it, you know. Sitting on top of it is this little felt damper, okay, that like prevents it from vibrating. So it's like you don't want it to kind of resonate when you're playing other notes if you're not playing this note, so that damper sits there and kind of prevents it from resonating. Beneath it, there's this felt hammer, all right, that's ready to go. It's not doing anything, just sitting there, but it's ready to go. As soon as you press the corresponding key that corresponds to this hammer, this string, and this damper, the following thing happens. The damper moves up out of the way. The hammer gets launched by the velocity that you insert into the key, though there isn't really kind of a follow-through mechanical connection. Like, as soon as the hammer started to sweep up, it loses contact with the key and it's just flying in kind of free motion. It bounces off the string. So there's like a single point in time where you've inserted energy into that string. And after that, whatever you're doing on the key, pressing it harder, pressing it softer, makes no difference to the sound, okay? But as long as you hold the key, the damper stays up, and that string now starts to emit the energy, the mechanical energy you put into it starts to resonate it off as acoustic energy. So it'll resonate, 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 it's kind of losing energy. And then as soon as you release the key, the damper falls back down and truncates any remaining sound coming off of that note. All right, so that's our little, you know, analysis of how piano works. There's probably a lot more going on there. I'm not really a mechanical engineer or even acoustic engineer, but this is what I've seen when I've looked inside a piano, so I think it's how it works. All right, so now, let's talk a little bit about piano sounds. So, what happens if you play, for example, this F right here? All right, this is a note on the piano keyboard. Well, if you play it and you hold a mic up to the piano and you record it, you get some waveform that looks like this. This waveform is not super useful in being able to interpret the structure of the acoustic signal behind this key press, right? It's like, when I look at this, I see nothing. I just see, you know, jaggies, like there's some sound, I can't say much more. Computers can sometimes do better with these, though it is also challenging for computers to directly reason about these, what are called time domain signals. So what a lot of systems do and what humans do to try to analyze visually waveforms is the following. They use a different representation, which is called a spectrogram. Here's what a spectrogram looks like. Contrast that with, you know, the waveform, right? The waveform has time along the x-axis and amplitude along the y-axis. Like, you know, how much was the membrane in your microphone contorting as a function of time? That's really what the signal represents, right? What the spectrogram has is similar in some ways. The x-axis is still time, right? It's still a kind of temporal representation. But now the y-axis is split into a kind of full range of possible frequencies, where kind of the lower down you are on the y-axis, the lower the sine wave you're talking about is, or cosine, or whatever, the higher up, the higher the frequency. And now the darkness value inside this thing that looks like a weird little image tells you how much energy at that time was resonating for that frequency, right? It's kind of like you took a prism to the sound to break it up into all its component frequencies, and then you slid that along time. This is what a spectrogram is, right? If you know about Fourier transforms, you're really just doing a short-term Fourier transform, like with overlapping windows to get this.
Hey, Taylor, I have a question.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
So Stone says, does the spectrogram contain basically the same information, but like on a different subspace?
Yes, in fact, I mean, this is like some caveats, but basically yes. Like, for a given little snippet of this audio signal, when you do a Fourier transform to get the vector at that time step of like which frequency bucket's lit up, all right? If you're taking like linear algebra, you've probably heard of like change of basis. Like you can take a vector space, find a new kind of orthonormal basis, and basically just sort of re-represent the entire vector space in terms of that new basis, kind of like a rotation. Well, linear algebra, if you get deeper into it, into kind of like functional analysis and stuff like this, you know, vector spaces don't just have to be like conventional little vectors. You can have vector spaces where the objects in the vector space are themselves functions. Like you can think of a function sort of like a continuous vector, all right? You can show that what the Fourier transform is doing is just rotating the vector space of all possible little waveforms to a new basis, a new orthonormal basis that's composed of periodic waves, all right? And so what we're seeing here is actually the projection onto this new basis, right? And if you're just changing your basis, that is indeed a one-to-one mapping and is in fact invertible, which means you're not actually losing information about the underlying waveform. Now, caveat one, we're not actually doing this for one little thing. We're doing it for a bunch of overlapping regions, and there is some loss that happens there. There's kind of a trade-off between the temporal resolution and the frequency resolution you can capture. Two, what I'm showing you here is magnitude spectra. Like really, when you take that Fourier transform, if you want it not to be lossy, what you get out are complex numbers. Like they have imaginary components to represent phase. It's only one-to-one if you continue to represent phase, which we're gonna punt on throughout this talk and in the model, because it actually doesn't matter that much. So yes, it's one-to-one, but not really, if that makes sense. Does that answer your question? Cool, all right, sweet. All right, so now the first thing you should see now that we've projected this note to this new space is like there's some interesting structure, right? It, like first of all, it's actually kind of simple looking. It doesn't look nearly as crazy as the waveform. And two, there's kind of some patterns here. So let me tell you about both of them. First, I'd like to highlight what I would call the kind of spectral structure of this note. You can see down here, there's this whole bar of energy over time at this very low frequency, all right? That's what's called the fundamental frequency. If you were to play that exact sine wave on like a synthesizer, it would have the same pitch as this piano note. But piano notes, of course, are much more complex than simple sine waves. They have all these harmonics that happen as a result of kind of string physics, right? Like it's vibrating at kind of half, it period is half, where the string length is half the period, and then it's vibrating where the string length is the full period, and then like one third of the period. So you get all these integer multiples of the fundamental all lighting up, all right? yeah. Are there physicists out there who are like, oh my God, like this guy doesn't know what he's talking about. We'll talk about playing two notes at the same time in a second, but that's a great question. That's going to be a huge problem. Okay. So the fundamental, and then you got the harmonics, right? And what you can see is that roughly these kind of like just peaking here, these kind of have like roughly the same ratios over time, though they kind of downweight over time. So what I would say is, you know, and this is how we'll represent it in systems, is like one kind of representation that describes important information about this particular note, this particular piano, is what I'll call its spectral shape. Think of it as like a histogram of kind of which frequency buckets had the most energy across the whole duration of the note. And you can see the fundamental has the most and the harmonics kind of decay. That is typical often for pianos, all right? Now, what if you played a different note? Well, it's gonna have a different fundamental. This is an octave up, so its fundamental is, you know, one of the harmonics of the previous note. Because the fundamental is higher, the harmonics are now spaced wider out because they're integer multiples of the fundamental, right? It has kind of sparser frequency activations, and that characterizes the sound of this note. All right, now here's the first problem with supervised learning. If I were to play the same note on a different piano, if the pianos were in tune, we'd have the same fundamental frequency, but because of, you know, maybe all of a sudden we're playing on like a really crappy little piano, like a little spin it upright, this can fundamentally change the acoustics in the piano, and it can change the whole frequency profile. So maybe this note on this piano, the same note on this piano, looks like this, which is quite different. If you didn't encounter that in your data, you might not generalize well to it. All right, so that's the first issue. Now, the other property of the spectrogram that I'd like to highlight is the kind of temporal shape, right? There's kind of a common temporal shape here too. And this is precisely because of our little cartoon of a piano string, right? Like at the beginning, there's no noise because you haven't pressed the key yet. You press the key, the damper goes up. All of a sudden the string starts, has a bunch of energy. It takes a little while before that kind of like hits its peak, acoustic energy. And then the energy sort of resonates off of the string with time and it decays. And then you release the key and it just truncates the sound right there. It just stops, right? This truncation property is something we'll actually use later in the model, right? One of the things this means is that if you play the same note but for a shorter duration, all it does to the temporal shape is just shorten it. It doesn't kind of reshape it, which is nice. Another thing is if you play the note softer, it may reshape the temporal shape, but approximately we can view it as just sort of like scaling it down. So that's one way we can accommodate this in the model. Now, coming back to kind of issues with supervised learning, what about differences in temporal shape across pianos? Well, there you get almost as pronounced an effect as with the spectral shape. On a really small piano, you're gonna have bad sustain. When you press a key and hold it, it won't make a sound that's loud for very long. So you might see a sharp decay like on the spinet. On a huge Bösendorfer concert grand, it'll have a much better sustain. So you might have very different temporal profiles. This will also confuse systems that weren't trained specifically on the piano you're trying to transcribe. Okay, now, so these are why we'd like to be able to, for example, fit the parameters of our model directly to the piano we're trying to transcribe. But one of the things we'll have to deal with, all right, is something that makes piano music transcription particularly difficult. And that is the fact that the piano is a polyphonic instrument, meaning you can play multiple notes simultaneously. So someone asked earlier, and this is a question I was gonna bring up in the talk anyway, what happens when you play two notes at the same time? Let's say you play this F we've been talking about, and then you simultaneously play this higher F that we've also talked about briefly. Well, practically speaking, strictly speaking, what I'm about to describe is a cartoon. Though if you were doing the complex, spectral representations where you included phase, this would be strictly true. But because we're just representing these as real numbers, it's only approximately true. Approximately, the spectrogram that you would actually hear if I played this octave simultaneously, it's like the kind of sum of the two previous spectrograms. It's the two spectrograms kind of superimposed on top of one another. Now, This, I argue, creates a huge problem for transcription. The reason is that when someone plays the piano, you don't get to see the separate spectrograms. You see the superimposed spectrogram. So if someone played this octave, you would see the spectrogram below. Now, because of uncertainty about the actual spectral shape of notes on this particular piano, there's ambiguity. What you don't know is the following. You don't know, is this two notes, like we know it truly is, it's the kind of two octaves, which had these two spectral profiles that got added together to kind of like add a lot of extra energy on that first harmonic right there? Or is this just, is this just the lower F being played, but this piano's kind of wonky, so like its spectral profiles are weird and like not super monotonic, right? So like, to answer this question, we really have to be jointly reasoning about fitting to the piano at hand, where we're also trying to disentangle which notes were played. This is called a source separation problem, right? Now, of course, in real piano music, you're not just playing like two notes at the same time, you're playing like a bunch of notes. So real spectrograms look crazy like this. So this is like a pretty hard problem, okay? So this is why we wanna move away from supervised learning. These are the challenges we're gonna encounter. The approach is the following. We're gonna try to fit to the piano at hand in a way that kind of best matches the acoustic data we actually get to see from it, while at the same time we're trying to disentangle all the notes as spectrograms are being played so we can figure out the actual sheet music. All right? Unsupervised transcription. So how do you actually accomplish this?
There's some more questions. They're asking about interference. Would the fundamental frequency change, or are there multiple peaks?
Some kind of weird interference would happen, I'm guessing. So destructive and constructive interference are like not well modeled by this process, precisely because we've deleted phase information. So again, if these were complex spectra where you actually had both, you know, phase and period, then that all gets modeled through the addition of the spectrograms. When you're talking about magnitude spectra where you've deleted the kind of imaginary numbers at the end that represent phase, this is not strictly true. And there are some artifacts in our system that result from that, though they're relatively minor. One of the things we did see in analysis is that sometimes you get like there was actually destructive interference in the acoustic signal that our model doesn't know about. So it looks like a little bit of silence and it'll think you released the note right there, even though you didn't. But it happens rarely enough that it's kind of okay. That's a great question. Does that make sense?
He says that, that wasn't a question. He's just guessing at what would happen.
Yeah, so there would be issues. That's right. Okay, so unsupervised transcription. And this is going to be kind of a general reversal of approach that is common to a lot of unsupervised methods, right? So again, we're never going to get data that looks like here was the audio signal, here was the right symbolic music. All we're going to get is data that's like, here's the audio signal. So how can we possibly fit a model? Well, the way we do this is as follows. We actually build is a model that goes the opposite direction. This is sometimes called a generative model, right? A generative model often, this isn't kind of formally true, but often a generative model, instead of conditioning on the input to produce the thing you want, all right, it instead tries to explain the input in terms of the things you want, right? So what we actually want is symbolic music and possibly the parameters of the piano. Those are not the outputs of the model. Those are the inputs of the model, all right? What the model is going to do is if you hand it some piano parameters and you hand it your hypothesized symbolic music, the generative model will act sort of like a piano synthesizer. It'll say, okay, well, if you, that's what you think the piano is and that's what you think the sheet music is, so let me try it. Like, I'll make an audio waveform and then I'll compare it. If it really looks like the input audio signal, maybe you got it right. If it really doesn't, go back and find some different symbolic music, different piano parameters. You got it wrong, all right? And what we'll do in learning is simultaneously search for the best piano parameters and the best actual sheet music that together is closely explain the actual observed audio signal as possible, right? If we've done that, we say, aha, we solved the puzzle. We found the sheet music that would give rise to this acoustic signal in conjunction with these piano parameters, okay? So, of course, to get this to work, the generative model isn't just some huge neural net. It has to have a much more articulated process in it. It has to kind of essentially be a cartoon of a piano synthesizer that we can actually do optimization in, right? It's not actually going to be a piano synthesizer. I'm going to be saying stuff throughout, like, we sample activations and then we sample a spectrogram to generate a spectrogram to generate a waveform. Never in our code are we actually generating waveforms, right? What I'm doing is describing the kind of probabilistic cartoon by which our system reasons about the data we give it. It's saying like, okay, I think I get how piano music works, all right? It works like through this generative model you gave me. Now my job is to search for the parameters in symbolic music, then when I push them into your little synthesizer, they give me the audio signal. The generative model is implemented in our code as a bunch of mathematical equations. It's not actually a synthesizer, right? But the best way to present it is in terms of the probabilistic assumptions it makes about piano synthesis. So for the next section of the talk, we're gonna be talking about like, what would it look like to sample audio files from our model, right? Of course, it has to be kind of articulated. It has to have a lot of inductive bias in it. In supervised learning, you teach the model what you want it to learn by giving it billions of hand-labeled examples. In unsupervised learning, you teach the model what you want by kind of injecting inductive bias directly into the structure of the model and letting it learn the rest. So that's kind of the dichotomy here. All right, so here we're gonna kind of do a two-pass, a coarse view of our generative model, the statistical cartoon of how we synthesize piano audio. We'll do a fine pass, a little more detail, and then I'll talk about how we actually do learning and inference on a GPU, and then I'll show you a demo. All right, so here's the thing we want, right? And like I said, this is actually at the very top of the model. The model's gonna go downward to turn this into what we get, which is the audio file. So we'd like to, from this MIDI file, actually produce the audio. So I'm gonna show you kind of zoomed in for a single note on the piano keyboard, what the whole process looks like, and then I'll show you how it's kind of just copies of this process for all the notes together, all right? So we zoom in on this particular row of the MIDI, we can visualize it like this. You know, there's time, and then there's this kind of blue step function that tells you when a note was played. The height of the step function tells you how hard you played it, like the velocity with which you hit the key, right? So rests are just when the function's at zero, notes are when it's above zero, right? And these are discrete, meaning that like these are hard decisions about on or off, though there is a continuous decision about velocity, but these are never gonna be curves. They're gonna be these discrete chunks, step functions. Now, we'll call this random variable in our model m sub n. It's like the nth note for the MIDI random variable, which is like this big old mega random variable. Now, to generate the MIDI, right, we have to have a prior in our model to make this a full statistical cartoon. This is a Bayesian approach. The prior on the MIDI is gonna be this simple little probabilistic model of what well-formed music sounds like. If you sample from this, you get terrible music, but it just encodes some really simple knowledge about music. There's parameters that govern how frequently you change from play to rest with what probability. There's parameters that govern the distribution on like how long you hold notes for, and there's parameters that govern the velocity. We'll talk more about that in a second, but it's like a little tiny cartoon of music. And we'll call those parameters mu sub n. Now the first step of our model, as we kind of make our way from the symbolic representation up top to the continuous representation at the bottom, the audio form, the first step is what I'll call the activation sequence for this note. And this is our first continuous random variable in this model. So the activation sequence is gonna be kind of on the x-axis exactly the same as the note events, as representing time, the full time of the song. On the y-axis now, instead of saying discrete things like, did you play this note or not? And what velocity did you set it to? The activation is actually gonna try to smooth this out to represent a continuous physical property of the piano, which would be like how much energy, acoustic energy, is coming off of this particular string as a function of time, right? And because we've seen what happens when you press a keyboard note, we know that the actual activations don't look like a step function. They're gonna be these little kind of curvy things with the Ks. And so this is our first random variable that's modeling that. We'll call that A sub n. Now, here's where the first parameters that are part of the model that are actually governing kind of specific properties of the piano you're trying to transcribe. These are the temporal shape parameters, all right? So this is just like the cartoon we saw earlier. For each note on the piano keyboard, including this nth note that we're zoomed in on right now, we're going to have a vector alpha sub n that looks something like this. This says, for this note on this piano, how quickly does the energy rise and decay? Generally, whenever you play this note. And you can imagine, like, if you kind of take this little red thing with the step functions up top and you kind of use the red things to replace the step functions, you get something like this activation. So that's kind of our first set of piano parameters. Now, the next step.
Your question?
Oh, yeah.
So when it comes to live performances, sometimes a note, say a quarter note, is not played for exactly one count in time. How does the model know to deal with those little noises or errors in live performances?
Great question. So one thing to note about MIDI is that MIDI time is not like beat time, right? These are not kind of metronome beats. MIDI time is real world millisecond time. So from the beginning, our representation is trying to get at like exactly what millisecond you played a note and how long before you released it. These little cartoons I have in here of like, you know, a quarter note, for instance, those are just there to kind of make you think like, yeah, this is related to sheet music. We're not actually constraining the model to have to produce kind of quantized note durations. Good question. Cool. All right. So the next step, as we kind of go down, we're kind of adding more and more signal information to the output to get to the audio signal. So the next step is where the spectral shape of this note on this piano comes in. What we're going to generate from the activations is a matrix that is now the component spectrogram for this note. The way you should think of this spectrogram, it would be like if somebody cut all the strings in the piano except the nth string, and then the player just continued to play their piece. And you took the waveform that came out and computed the spectrogram. This is what you'd see. It's a spectrogram only of the kind of acoustic signal coming from just this note. All right? We'll call this S sub n. And again, here we have, you know, another set of piano-specific parameters, this time the spectral shape parameters. This is a vector sigma sub n. And depending on how you set it, it tells you what this note's spectral shape is on this particular piano, right? So by changing alpha and sigma for all the notes, it lets you adapt to the specific piano at hand, is the idea. Now finally, as I mentioned, right, this is happening in parallel for all the notes on the piano keyboard. That's what these plates indicate. And what we actually observe is the kind of spectrogram of all the notes being played simultaneously, which I'll call X, and which I've shaded in, which is typical notation in these. This is a graphical model, formally what I'm showing. In a graphical model, random variables are nodes. When you shade a node in, it means it's observable in your data. All the ones that are not shaded in are latents. We actually can't see their values. We're gonna have to infer their values using statistical inference. Okay, so that was the course pass on the model. One thing to note, all these kind of blue things over here are strictly speaking latent variables. And all these red things over here are strictly speaking parameters, though our treatment during inference and optimization is going to kind of conflate that boundary. We're going to kind of treat them the same way and infer them jointly, because after all, we're trying to kind of get both at the same time. All right. I'll zoom in a little more detail. This talk's going longer than I thought. Is that okay?
Yeah, that's fine.
Okay. I'll try to speed up a little bit. All right. So note of it, Mom, there's not a lot of super interesting stuff going on here. Right, we're trying to like give you a little more detail on what is this prior distribution that generates the symbolic sequence for each note. It works like this. This variable is broken down into a bunch of sub-variables. There's a sequence of kind of discrete variables that say, did you play or did you rest? These are just binary variables. They come in a Markov chain. And the parameters that govern this Markov chain is like this little matrix that says like, how likely are you to transition from play to rest or play to play, et cetera, all right? Now, conditioned on those discrete choices, we then generate continuous durations. Given that you played this note, how long did you play it for? Same for all these guys. And here we have another little set of parameters that govern the distribution on durations for each note. All right? They're specific to the note type, but nothing else. So this is a very simplistic model of music. Finally, we generate the velocity of each note from a separate distribution. All right, that says for this note, whenever you play it, how likely are you to set it to play it how hard? All right, and that generates all the velocities. Together, all these little subvariables connected in this little subgraphic model I've denoted gives you the full form of the prior on M sub n. All right, the next step, oh, right, and here's all the parameters mu sub n for that prior. The next step is we need to take these symbolic imps of n sequence, and we need to convert it to the activation. So how does that work? Well, visually, here's exactly how it works. You've already generated whether you're going to play a note or not in a sequence. You've already generated durations for all the notes you're going to play. So you actually know the, you know, total time of each note and each rest in between them. So you know the total time of the piece. And you know the velocity. So all you really have to do is kind of convert these to their continuous shapes and then stitch them together into a long time series. That's the generative process for this step. Like, again, this is how our model thinks about synthesis. So to tell you exactly how that works, all we have to do is zoom in on one of these boxes to tell you how to generate the corresponding segment. And the way this works harkens back to our little discussion of kind of temporal shape within a piano and how it's actually kind of simple. When it gets truncated, it stops early. And when you play it softer, we're just going to say it gets scaled down. So what we do is we look up the general temporal shape parameter for this note, for this key on this piano. We copy it. We truncate it to the duration we generated in the last step to make it the right length, all right? Then we scale it by the velocity to kind of accommodate volume control. And then we add a little bit of Gaussian noise to model things like destructive interference and just to like give the model a little leeway to not have to like exactly perfectly fit the data, all right? It's modeling noise. So that might add a little jiggle there, all right? We do that for all the segments, we stitch them together, and now we got the activations. All right. Now the next step is when you take the activations, combine them with what our current spectral parameters are for this note to generate the component spectrogram for this note. As you may have kind of guessed, right, those spectrograms are so simple. The reason they're simple is because they're very low rank matrices. Really, they're approximately the outer product between these two vectors, right? Like basically you're taking the spectral shape and smearing it left to right across the screen, weighted by the activation. That's exactly what an outer product between two vectors would do. So that's what we do in our model. We just say we take the simple outer product and then we treat the resulting spectrogram. We have a little bit of a fancy trick we play. We say this is like a Poisson noise distribution. It lets us do a mathematical trick later on, but it doesn't really matter. Poisson noise, that's the component spectrogram. Finally, we need to get the observation at the bottom. That's the simplest part. Sum all these component spectrograms together. That's the fine-grained view of what's happening in our statistical cartoon of piano synthesis. Now, let's talk about how we actually learn this thing from just X, which is the whole goal, all right? So a couple notes first. First of all, what do we not have to learn? Well, I contend that we do not have to learn the parameters on the prior for the MIDI itself, because it's fairly easy to go to the internet and just download a whole bunch of MIDI, random MIDI data. And so that's exactly what we do. We download a bunch of random MIDI data where you can actually observe imps of n, and we fit mu sub n to that data and we freeze it. So this kind of forms a fixed and well-informed prior for our whole model, which is helpful. So we're not gonna have to learn that, all right? Here's something else we're not gonna have to learn. I'm not gonna go into too much detail why. Suffice it to say, because of our little Poisson trick that I alluded to for a second, and the fact that the sum of Poisson random variables is also Poisson, there is a closed form and tractable way of actually integrating out S sub n, right? Like if you know, like if you have a joint distribution on three variables and you wanna make one of them go away, you marginalize over it, like you sum over it. If that variable is continuous, that means you integrate over it. That's what we do for S sub n. We don't actually care about the values of that. If we can make them go away, we would. We can, so we do. We integrate them out. What's left are the temporal parameters of the piano that we'd like to figure out because we're trying to fit this piano, the spectral parameters of the piano, the note events, which is the actual transcription we want out, and then also the activation simply because we can't efficiently marginalize over them. So we're just going to punt and say, well, we'll just try to max over them too. What learning is going to look like is the following. I'm not actually going to write equations. I'm just going to say in words. It's kind of intuitive. What we're going to do is we're going to start with random assignments to all these variables, alpha, sigma, m, and a for all notes on the piano keyboard, all right? For any assignment of them, we can compute what probability they assign to x, like how much that current setting explains what we observe, the input spectrogram, right? Our goal is to find settings of alpha, sigma, m, and a that maximize that probability, that best explain the data we actually saw. So to do that, we're going to do something called block coordinate ascent. Technically, in this model, it has a much fancier name. It's called mean field or iterated conditional modes. But there's no need for all that. It's actually quite simple. What we do is, I said, we initialize them randomly. We do the following. We loop through each variable. First, we'll pick up alpha, and we'll say, can we try to improve the probability by changing alpha with everything else held fixed? If we can, we do it. Then we'll pick up sigma. Can we improve the probability with everything else held fixed? If we can, we do it. Then M, then A, then start over again, go back to alpha. Keep looping through all the variables, trying to make progress just on that variable separately, conditioned on the current settings of the others, until the process converges. All right? So what I need to explain to you to make that clear is, what are these updates? How could you actually, if you knew alpha, sigma, and A, how could you quickly find the best setting of M? Similarly for A, similar for alpha, et cetera. I'm not going to write the formulas, but I'll kind of tell you roughly. So if you know A, alpha, and mu, these are actually the only things that matter for M. The stuff lower down doesn't actually affect it. All right. It turns out you can import from natural language processing this really useful dynamic program called the Semi-Markov dynamic program. And you can use this in polynomial time to figure out the best way to change M, if everything else is fixed, to improve your total likelihood. So that's our update step for the nodes. For the temporal shape, I did out some math, a little bit of algebra, a little bit of calculus, wasn't too bad. This, it turns out, has a simple closed form update. It's like, grab all the different segments that are appropriate, kind of average them together, do a little math, and that tells you how to update alpha. All right, basically, if you're in 151, what I did was, I computed the gradient of the likelihood with respect to alpha with A and M held fixed, so like the partial derivative with respect to alpha. I set it equal to zero, and I solved for alpha. That's the way you get a closed form update that maximizes the probability. All right, now the activations and the spectral shapes are a little bit more tricky. These, we're gonna basically use the age-old approach of gradient descent, all right? But they're all positive. They have to be positive, they can't be negative. So we use something called exponentiated gradient descent. This is a way of doing gradient descent, or ascent, since we're trying to increase the likelihood. This is a way of doing gradient descent with the constraint that your variables are positive. It's like a slightly fancier version. The good news about this setup is that even though there's no neural nets in our model under the hood actually looks a lot like a neural net. It's got a lot of these matrix multiplies and like vector gradient updates going on. So what I did, and this was before PyTorch, I wrote a bunch of CUDA code that actually runs these on the GPU. I've since then converted this CUDA code to OpenCL so it can run on the GPU on my Mac laptop. What this means is it's like 1,000x faster than the CPU version. I'll actually be able to transcribe a whole recording from a Bach piece live in like 30 seconds. It can actually happen in real time if you wanted to. So that's one cool side. Let me tell you how we're going to evaluate. We evaluate by looking at onset F1. This is one of the most common metrics for this task. It basically punts on the offsets because you can't hear them as well. It says, here's a ground truth transcription. What was your predicted transcription? If all your onsets are within epsilon of the ground truth, you get positive accuracy points. If you don't, that's an error. So we compute F1, which is like an accuracy metric. Here's some baseline systems. Some of these are unsupervised systems that don't try to do the spectral decomposition. Others are heuristic systems that don't really do learning. That some of them have kind of components of what we do, but none of them jointly try to do the disentanglement into different notes while fitting to the piano at hand, all right? And you can see they're getting accuracies almost up to like 70% on this standard corpus called the MAPS corpus, where you have a bunch of audio that's been transcribed so we can evaluate. Here's a supervised system that we built, and it turned out it generalizes well enough to actually beat all the previous unsupervised methods, so that was a little bit scary. But here are the results with our system. When you actually do the full-fledged approach I talked about, you get a pretty big gain over both previous unsupervised systems that don't reason about disentanglement and previous supervised systems because you can actually fit to the piano you care about. So we're now up to roughly an accuracy of like 82% on real, live, virtuoso classical piano music, which is kind of cool. So here's an example transcription. Here was the correct output. Here's what our system produced when you convert it back to sheet music. You can see the errors are in red. We overpredict some of these notes, all right? One thing you'll notice in the demo I'll show is that the errors we make are interesting in a way. The errors we make don't sound like errors when you play them back. And that's because the problem with that source separation issue was disentangling notes that have overlapping harmonics, right? Well, it turns out that notes that have overlapping harmonics are consonant with one another. They sound good together. They sound fairly similar. So when we make mistakes, it's because there are a lot of overlapping harmonics. But the good news is the mistakes we make have overlapping harmonics with the truth. So they often sound okay. We're not going to like predict something off by a half step. We may well predict something being off by an octave or a fifth. So that's kind of good news, depending on what the goal is for your system. Now, here's an acoustic demo. This is like a little preview of the actual live demo I'm gonna do. So first I'll play the actual recording, just a little snippet of it. This is the input to the model. Now we run that through our system, get the MIDI, import it to GarageBand, play the MIDI on a piano synthesizer. Here's the sound you get back. So it kind of sounds the same. It's like maybe a slightly worse pianist, right? But like kind of, they're playing the same music probably. Now here's one cool thing you can do. Because it's MIDI, we can make it any synthesizer we want. So here is a famous pianist playing Grieg on a guitar. That just illustrates that I'm not lying to you. We actually are going to symbolic music. I'm not just doing some audio transform on the input. I see your question. Could there be some kind of smoothing done post-learning where we would check for consistency? E.g., music tends to have patterns. So if the predicted MIDI has some similar patterns within some amount of difference, we would just force it to be the same. Yeah, so two things. One, that's kind of the point of, where'd it go? Sorry. That's kind of the point of this part of the model. So like effectively what you're doing here is you're learning, like, it's not very often that you play a note for a single millisecond. You often play it for much longer. So if the spectrogram you're seeing kind of looks like maybe you play it for a millisecond, think again, maybe smooth it out and connect it with a bigger note. So this prior will have that effect in biasing the model, which is good. But it's not perfect. It's also an independent prior for each note on the piano, which means it's the worst music prior model ever, right? It basically thinks that what note you're playing with your left hand has no correlation with what note you're playing with your right hand or any other note on the keyboard. So one way of interpreting what you're saying is that wouldn't it work better if we had a much stronger musical prior in the model? Like, what if we had a sophisticated neural net trained on all sheet music we could get access to that knows what well-formed music looks like? Wouldn't that help the model? The answer is absolutely yes. The problem is it substantially complicates inference. It's something we actually thought about and have been looking into. It's just that no students ever really taken it on as a full-fledged project yet. It's a great idea, and I bet it would improve things. We would just have to totally rework learning, which could be challenging, but also fun. Post-processing, like, is a more tractable idea, and you could definitely do that. Though one of the things we tried to avoid with this model, we were going for kind of maximum elegance. Post-processing is always viewed as kind of hacky. It's like, well, if you're doing it in post-processing, why didn't you just have your model know about it? So you definitely could do something like that to make it better. We're just sort of snobs about it, so we just didn't do any post-processing. But that's a great idea if you actually wanted to get the system working better, which we should care about. Okay, so now that's the end of the talk. Let me quickly do this demo, and then we can, if people are not too tired, we can do the Q&A part. All right, so share screen, share audio, desktop. All right, do you guys see my desktop? See a cat and a bunch of suns? Don't ask me why. Okay. So here's what we're going to do. So I tested this out. It does indeed work on my new laptop, which is great. So I'm gonna load this up, and it's gonna run in the background. It's gonna be fitting all the parameters with the updates we talked about, and then at the end of the day, it's gonna return MIDI. That's gonna automatically open in GarageBand, and then we'll play back the MIDI. While the system's transcribing, I'm gonna play the input audio file for you to hear. They take about the same amount of time because it's like almost at a real time rate. So here's the system running. Oh, how do I make it go back to the beginning? So I don't know if you could hear in the background of that song, but the pianist is actually humming a little bit. And this is because this is Glenn Gould, who's a dead but very famous pianist, playing the Goldberg Variations. He was well known for being like an absolutely awesome pianist, but also sort of infamous for being weird. And like he would in performances just like hum like things that don't even necessarily sound like the music. And you can hear that in the recordings. Hopefully it doesn't actually confuse the system. So here, now you can actually see, we did indeed get MIDI. You can see what it looks like MIDI. I'm gonna play it back for you. And let's have a little listen. You get the idea. So like a couple observations. One, note wise, like in terms of which notes are being played, that sounds probably more accurate than 82%. And that's because of the consonants proper that I talked about. Like there's a lot of wrong notes in there that weren't in the original music, but they sound like the original music. The other thing is that it sounds to me, like I said before, it sounds like a slightly worse pianist playing the same piece. And this is because like the model still struggles to like exactly get the onsets. Like they're kind of like jiggled a little bit, so it sounds like you're kind of, when you're playing your chords, you're accidentally kind of rolling them, like the timing isn't quite right. But one cool thing to note, I don't know if you could hear it, but like this doesn't sound like your typical 90s MIDI file that you downloaded from the internet that sounds like NES music. This still had dynamics in it, right? Like you could still hear kind of it getting louder and softer as the pianist touched the keyboard differently. And that's because of our velocity random variable in the model. When we extract MIDI, we also extract the velocity. So we make a guess at how hard the person was touching the piano. And that comes across here. You can hear it in the recording. Now, finally, I don't know if anybody actually thinks this is that cool. I think it's kind of cool to do this. Like, let's make a new synthesizer. I don't know, GarageBand, I can't figure out how to pick the synthesizer. I just make new ones and it picks a random one. That seems to work, but. So here's a classic electric piano. And so you get the idea, like once you have this in MIDI form, there's a lot more you can do remastering wise. Like you now have the kind of ground truth symbolic representation, and you can change the kind of auditory representation a lot more. So this is kind of a cool thing if you do audio remastering, stuff like this. Okay, that's all I have. Sorry that what I thought was a half hour talk turned into an hour and 5 minute talk, but I can stick around a bit longer to answer questions. So please shoot me questions. I see a question. Could this work on different instruments? Great question. We thought a little bit about this too. I think that, so like, the model makes some piano specific assumptions. One of the biggest ones was about how temporal shapes are modulated by key presses. So we had this assumption that the temporal shape is fixed for a note, essentially. The only thing differences in how long or how hard you press the key do is either truncate it or scale it up and down. For an instrument like the violin, this is not true. You can have kind of arbitrary temporal shapes depending on how you bow the string. And so this model would break. But for something like plucked guitar or harpsichord, where they really are kind of like discrete events where you kind of are only interacting with the string for a moment in time, then those same assumptions may well hold, and this might work reasonably, though we haven't tried it yet. Okay, another question. Could you adapt this to extract only melody or harmony? Yeah, that's an interesting question. There are supervised systems that directly just try to extract like the melodic theme or just the sequence of chords. And those do indeed, I think, generalize slightly better. We haven't thought about making an unsupervised system for doing that, but I think that would be an interesting way to go. There, you'd have to have more in the kind of model, in the music model, to kind of figure out what parts of the sound you were gonna call melody or chords. But the good news is you could kind of punt more on the rest. You wouldn't have to articulate each note. You could just sort of generate like harmonic textures perhaps. So in some ways it might get a little harder, in some ways it might get a little easier. It'd be an interesting research project. Here's a question. Is this software you wrote available for people to download and play around with? Yes, absolutely. It's open source. You can grab it on my GitHub. I hope it'll run out of the box. Like the CPU version will run out of the box, but it's really slow. The GPU version, I tried to include the necessary like DLLs for OpenCL. If you just drop them in the folder as a code and you use the shell script, it worked on my Mac right now. Like I'd not installed any of this. I just downloaded the demo and clicked run and it worked. I don't know if it'll work on other systems, but you can definitely run the CPU version. You can also get to it from my website if you can't find my GitHub. I'm pretty sure you can get to it from my website. If not, like GitHub is just tberg12. That's my GitHub ID. Okay, let's see. Is that the Glenn Gould Goldberg 1955 version? I think it's the 81 version. Yeah, I think it's the 81 version, but good question. there was two in this folder. I think I had like Glenn Gould 1, Glenn Gould 2. One of them is the 55, one of them is the 81. I think this one was the 81 because the audio mastering sounded better. Like they have better recording techniques. Here's a question. Is there a way to transcribe, let's say, pop music to piano transcription? Yeah, in theory, right, you could design a system like that, like this for that. The problem again, though, is that there you have like so many different types of sounds and instruments that it would be much harder to like kind of make the right modeling assumptions in the model and have them hold true. But maybe you could do something like someone was mentioning earlier, where it's like you're not actually trying to get the full MIDI transcript. You just want the melody and the chord progressions. And maybe you could build a different kind of model that was related but kind of punted more on the rest of the notes and just described it as a texture that would work on pop music. That would be a cool project. All right, here's another question. What courses or concepts were essential to create this project? Any recommended undergrad courses? Yeah, great question. So let's see, I can kind of map this back onto the courses I took and needed to do this. So one would be 151A, which is the Intro to ML course that I teach, and so does Kamalika and Sanjay. The other one that could be useful, though technically there are no neural nets in here, but it still would be useful, would be like 151B, which is gonna be the replacement for 154, which is about neural nets. Beyond that, you would need to get into graduate level courses. Like you need to take probably the 250 machine learning sequence, 250A, which is about probabilistic graphical models and variational inference. Actually, probably just 250A. Most of what we were doing here is like variational probabilistic graphical modeling. Then the other thing that I did not take, but would have been useful to take, is signal processing. Like I had to sort of like teach myself how to do signal processing-ish. For this project, and I'm still probably saying some things wrong. Yeah, like you can usually for research projects, like if you know like two out of the three component areas, you can kind of like fake it on the last one and make do. And that was signal processing was my just trying to get by one. But yeah, check out 250A. If you've taken 151A and you've done really well and you feel like you have a solid math background, like maybe you've done a minor or major in math, I would suspect you could do just fine in 250A. But it's also fine to save it for grad school and take the equivalent course there and then start doing this stuff. All right, another question. Do you have any tips or suggestions for how for undergrads looking to do research in AI and machine learning? I'm currently in CSE 151B this quarter. Yeah, so yeah, I get this question a lot and I've tried to think about it a lot. From what I've seen, both as when I was an undergrad getting involved in research and now as a faculty member advising undergrads on research, the best way to get involved in research is to kind of identify a topic area and therefore a professor that's doing something you're interested in, then take the kind of main upper division course they teach and nail it. Like get as close to an A+ as you can and talk to them a lot so they kind of get to know you. At that point, probably ask them, hey, I really want to do research with you. What else do you think I need? Like often it's a little bit early to get involved in research if you've never taken a single graduate course, because graduate courses are really where you get taught how to do research. Almost all professors will have the graduate course that they teach that is designed to teach students how to do research in their lab, essentially. And so what you could ask is like, I really want to do research with you. I know I might not quite have the background yet, but I did really well in your course. And like, hopefully you've got to know me and you can kind of see that, you know, I'm interested in this stuff. Could I take your graduate course? And if I do well, is it possible I could do research? At that point, some professors will just say, no, it's too full. I don't have time. Whatever. Screw them. Other professors will be like, yeah, like, sure. Let me try to figure out how to save a spot for you in the graduate course. I think you could do it. Come take it. And then we can talk more. Then you take the graduate course. It would be hard for you. They're hard. But most people get A's because they don't grade very hard in graduate courses. It's not really about grades. So it's not really going to impact your GPA. And at the end, you'll probably have enough knowledge to do research. And because the professor probably already kind of gave you a tacit yes, like they're like, yeah, okay, that's a good plan. Come take it. They're much more likely to then say, yes, come do research in my lab. So that's kind of a long process. But it is probably from what I've seen, and I don't know everything about this, because I don't see what's happening in all other labs, but from what I've seen, that's probably the most surefire way. Now, another good way is just to ask a bunch of professors. You can get lucky, and you can find a professor who, like this quarter, has a project that they need some more fast. It doesn't require a ton of background. They bring you in, you do that project, and now you're part of the lab, and you do the next cool project after that. The kind of depth approach is find a professor, stalk them, take all their classes, like do really well. The other approach is the breadth approach, literally email everyone. Like no hard feelings when professors say no, don't take it personally. It's usually just because they're insanely busy and you should expect a lot of no's before you get a yes. So that'd be my kind of like broad advice. Here's another question. As a new transfer student whose main interest is in natural language processing, what are good ways to get involved with NLP at UCSD? So the best way would be to take NLP classes. So Nadapa teaches an undergrad class called 156. If you've had like 151A, you could probably go straight into 156. She also teaches a graduate level NLP class that is kind of related to 156. It's kind of like an advanced version. And then I teach like an even more advanced, like super hardcore statistical NLP graduate course. It's a 291. You should probably kind of look at the syllabi for that set of courses, figure out where you feel comfortable and just jump right in. You can always take the next one after that. And that will be a way for you to kind of get direct contact with the NLP professors here. Myself, Nadapa, Jingbo, Julian, others, Leon Bergen is another professor in the Ling and Cogs department. Get contact with them, get knowledge of the material. So then you can start thinking about ways to actually kind of take graduate courses or start up on research projects. Here's another question. Could we use this model for differentiating what type of piano? Yeah, that's a good idea. Yeah, so yeah, I don't know. I'd be interested. One thing I've always wanted to do is like to like focus less on the MIDI that the model actually transcribes, but pay closer attention to the spectral and temporal parameters the model learns. One, because they're kind of a fingerprint of the piano, like you say. And so like, what if there was some mystery recording that we didn't know like which concert hall it was recorded in, but somehow we could like use its spectral fingerprint and do a compare and be like, aha, that was played in Carnegie Hall in 1952. Like that'd be a really neat historical discovery. I'm sort of doubtful that could happen, but it'd be really neat. The other thing is like, technically this is a synthesizer. Like we've never tried it, but you could, once you've learned a piano, Now push new MIDI through it and see if you can actually synthesize convincing piano that sounds like the piano you trained from. Or if you converted this to be like a more general model that could learn from like electronically synthesized music, now you could fit it to like, you know, some cool 1980s pop where like they had some cool setting of all the dials on their, you know, Moog analog synthesizer that everybody's forgot how to recreate that sound on the Moog. You train this on their recording, and now you have a fully fledged Moog synthesizer with all the right knob settings, and then you can play new music in that sound. It'd be kind of cool. So yeah, I'm very interested in like what you could do with the spectral stuff apart from the MIDI, though we haven't really explored it. What's a good idea? Your question may be slightly different. Thinking along the lines that models perform differently on different pianos, so we could take the accuracies and compare using that. Yeah, So like, the problem is that there's not a ton of ground truth transcribed data to do this evaluation on. The MAPS corpus is all on like, I think, two pianos, maybe one piano in two different environments. So like, it's kind of hard because it requires more supervised data to do this measurement of like, which pianos are harder, which pianos cross-generalize, that we just don't have annotated. But if we did, yeah, you could definitely do that kind of cross comparison. Cool. Any last questions? All right. Well, thank you all for attending the talk. I had a great time. I haven't gotten to play with that demo in a long time. I haven't gotten to give these slides in a long time. It's one of my favorite talks. So I had a good time. One final thing, like if you want to ask me more about stuff like getting involved in research and applying to graduate school, just anything, I'm actually on the undergrad committee this quarter, probably next quarter too. And so I hold UGCOM office hours every Friday. Right now they overlap with my 151 office hours because there hasn't been a ton of turnout. We might change that later, but you know, like there's a time where you show up and we can just sit and I can answer in detail any questions, give any advice you need about getting involved in research. And please come, you know, we don't get a lot of students yet for UGCOM, but I'm trying to get more. You can look up the Zoom link and the time. It's on the UCSD calendar, UCSD CSE calendar. Here's a question. Is there any way to attend if you aren't CSE? Yeah, great. I think it's just a general UCSD. I don't know. Maybe you can't. So, do you have any friends in the CSE department? Yeah, could just ask them to grab the calendar. I don't have the Zoom link on me, but like it's an unrestricted Zoom link. So like if somebody just hands it to you, you can use it. And it's the same Zoom link every week. If you email me, I can also remember and follow up and send it to you later. Yeah, anyone can join. I just don't know if you can grab the Zoom link from anyone off the calendar, but maybe. The link is on the website. Sweet. Okay, there you go. All right, well, with that, I guess close down. We can all go eat some dinner or do whatever we do on Fridays in the age of COVID. Thanks again for inviting me, Jason. This is a great venue. I hope you guys keep it up. Let me know if you want me to help corral any more AI professors, get them to talk in here. I can help with that if you want.
Oh, yeah, that'd be great.
Sure.
Yeah, thanks for giving this talk.
No problem. All right. Well, be well, everyone, and see you around UCSD. Or not, or maybe with the vaccine eventually, but, you know, yeah, right, okay. All right, goodbye.
All right, bye.